pleasure to be here. It's about regionalization in academia, let's say. So it's pretty well into a Nordic network meeting. And these kinds of things are parts that are isolated, and then other parts of the complete picture are ignored. And that's what it means that I want to talk about the title. I want to talk about the right to ignore certain phenomena, for instance, to ignore human nature, which is, as Nishir just said, my book topic, but the topic is also how scientists, for instance, cultural anthropologists, manage and legitimately to ignore human nature. And with that, I'm trying to give you an epistemic defense of the nature culture divide. So since antiquity, the distinction between nature, physis in Greek, roughly what we inherit biologically, and culture, nomos, roughly today at least, and in the context that I'm focusing on, what is acquired by social interaction is a commonplace in science and society. But recently it has come under attack as well in philosophy as well as in cultural anthropology itself. And at the same time, nature-culture, as a conceptual divide, is and was quintessential for cultural anthropology. So the social science that I'm focusing on is cultural anthropology. The perspective integral to cultural anthropology is that culture is the field-defining phenomenon, so it's the explanandum, but also an important explanant. More on that later. Nature, then, is negatively defined as not culture. And as a, in that negative way of defining it, as a disciplinary primitive, something that can legitimately be ignored. And the right to ignore that I want to present here today is similar to what William James, the pragmatist at the beginning of the 20th century, claimed, that we can epistemically ask for a right to believe in the absence of complete evidence or sure knowledge, the right to believe. And notice that ignoring is not the same as negating. But if you ignore human nature, you still use the nature-culture divide, the two concepts, epistemically in order to provide disciplinary primitives. And the right to ignore, I want to show, can be justified, and I will use a historical case from the history of cultural anthropology, namely the case of Alfred Lewis Kroeber, one of the first professional anthropologists in the US, who himself defended for himself and his colleagues the right to ignore by taking what I call a separationist stance. A separationist stance is an epistemic research heuristic that defends the right to ignore X either as a phenomenon or as a causal factor in an explanation typical for a disciplinary field, for instance, ignoring human nature as Kroeber did. I will defend two arguments. The first one is the general argument against the synthesis bias, a bias towards integration. In principle, that's the argument, a separationist stance is as good as an integrationist stance, since it can be equally epistemically fruitful. The second argument is a specific one in defense of the nature-culture divide. The divide can be an epistemic mean for fruitful research in that it provides disciplinary primitives that allow for fruitful separation of kinds of explanations typical for a disciplinary field. That's how I'm gonna proceed. I will first present you the epistemic critique of the nature-culture divide, then say something on the argument from integration, and then show you how nature and culture got separated in evolutionary contexts. It's the case of Mozart in Samoa, with which I want to establish the two arguments, and then pour something on it takes two to tango, and integration as a regulative idea, and then further consequence, and the tree of science. Mary Mitkey, philosopher, in her classic book on Beast and Man, wrote, I quote, "In modern times, science, because of its tremendous prestige, has been woke to dramatize all these splits, that is nature, culture, mind, body, thought versus feeling, in a way that often has little to do with any real scientific work, but that seems to bring an unanswerable authority to the side that can exploit it. This reductive move adds a damaging warfare between the two cultures, science and humanities, to the general chaos, deepening the gaps already opened by specialization between different studies and generally fragmenting the intellectual scene in a way that wastes endless time and resources. So conceptual splits are bad because of the motivation, authority claiming, and also because of the consequences. It's a waste of time and resources. Similarly, Clifford Geertz, anthropologist, in a famous paper on the impact of the concept of culture on the concept of man, says that there is a stratigraphic view of the relation between nature and culture. I quote, "In this stratigraphic conception, man is a composite of levels, each superimposed upon those beneath it and underpinning those above it. As one analyzes man, one peels off layer after layer, each such layer being complete and irreducible in itself, revealing another quite different sort of layer underneath." So he opts then for what he calls a synthetic view, and again, the divide between nature and culture, mind, body, take whatever you want, but nature and culture is at the focus, is bad, again, because of the motivation, disciplinary autonomy, authority claim. The 10 years focus on epistemic motivation, the relationships between disciplines, and the consequences. That's why I'm calling it an epistemic critique. The other critiques against the nature culture, which are more ontological, and maybe I have time in the discussion, they are far off from what I want to look at, so that's why I focus on that kind of critique. The critical question I want to pose is, are they ignoring the fruitfulness of conceptual divides like nature and culture? In other words, is there synthesis bias? And I want to show you, yes, there is. And they share this problem of having a synthesis bias with evolutionary psychologists who ask for integration of knowledge against the, what they call, standard social science model. As many of you probably know, that standard social science model is something like any position that claims autonomy from biological sciences on the basis of the distinction between culture or society and nature. The argument from integration. Outlining the reasons why social scientists should pay attention to, rather than ignore, the insights of evolutionist psychology, Barker-Gusmeeders and Tooby wrote, I read, "Conceptual integration generates this powerful growth in knowledge because it allows investigators to use knowledge developed in other disciplines to solve problems on their own." And a lot of examples come. "At present, crossing such boundaries is often met with xenophobia, packaged in the form of such familiar accusations as intellectual imperialism or reductionism. But by calling for conceptual integration in the behavior and social sciences, we are neither calling for reductionism nor for the conquest and assimilation of one field by another." So nobody involved in, at least nobody I know of or take seriously, in debates about evolution in culture ask for any kind of reductionism that would involve giving up the disciplinary structure of science and the pluralism that follows from that. So that means compatible but incongruent different perspectives. Not even evolutionist psychologists. And it's not Barker in this quote, it seems. The disciplinary structure, and that is something I would assume, is the bulwark against any call for imperialist unification via ontological, theoretical, or methodological reduction of social sciences to biological ones. Now, I'd be interested in what imperialism means and could mean. This here now is the perfect place where, even after next week, there is a conference on what imperialism means, and Uskali has a forthcoming paper, and probably there are many more papers from people here in this room on imperialism. And all I want to add to that is definitely that's not what they are after, at least given this quote. And generally, I think these accusations are often unjustified. And so let's focus on, because they are not assuming imperialism, well, that's not what they want, not reduction, but corrective integration. Now, what is that? What is corrective integration? In any case, I think it's a process, a research strategy of interdisciplinarily grading or checking for consistency between the different fields one is focusing on. And so, for instance, physical anthropology and cultural anthropology, or evolution psychology and cultural anthropology. This consistency checking and grading is creating constraints from one side to the other side, the two disciplines that should, perspectives that should come together. And then it can also, if it's constraining, it can also be involved in the interdisciplinary problem solving where knowledge from different fields can come together and the one is constraining the other. Why is it corrective? Because by the constraining you create a dependency. So the options you have in your theory or in your approach or model are restricted by the knowledge you take from the other field, because you need to make sure that there's a consistency between the fields. Now, corrective integration often has a direction of adaptation. So it's asymmetric. And usually that comes in the form, well, certainly cultural anthropologists have to check whether what they claim is consistent with biology. So if the evolutionary biologists find something out that is in conflict with the cultural anthropologists or the sociologists, they better adapt to what the evolutionary psychologists say. And the biologists, the psychologists have to adapt to the biologists, and they have to adapt to the physicists, etc., etc. But not the other way around. Just because the social scientists find something out that is in conflict with the evolutionary psychology, many would assume they don't have to adapt, because that's more fundamental. So I'm not a big fan of corrective asymmetry, but that's not my topic. What I want to say is, even if people assume corrective symmetry, the biologists also have to listen to what the social scientists have to say and have to adapt. So it's not clear. There's no hierarchy, not at all. Even if that is the case, we have to address the value of integration. Now, in the quote I've showed you from Barker-Donner, the reason why integration is good is because it is fruitful. It has produced new insights, new methods, new theories, or even new interfield areas. Fruitfulness is thus treated as a guiding epistemic value, and the normative claim attached to it is a theory should create new hypotheses, problems, evidences in one's own field, or between fields. Now, Barker-Donner make an implicit assumption in what they say on this issue, namely that integration and fruitfulness are so closely connected that therefore separation cannot be fruitful. This is what I label the argument from integration. That Barker et al. Are making that implicit assumption is clear from the context of the quotation. It's not in the quote. Because what they attack with their plea for conceptual integration are people like Kroger, and he especially is one of their targets, explicit targets, for ignoring what the evolutionary psychologists do, because that's how they define the standard social science model. They ignore the intellectual gifts of evolutionary psychologists. Oh, they ignore human nature. And so that's why, and that's their kind of an implicit assumption. If they don't have it, they might be fine, but let's just maybe you grant this. There's an implicit assumption, and this is the assumption I want to attack. because the regulative ideal attached to scientists should always aim at integration because it is spiritual. And the problem is there's a what I call a synthesis bias. This argument from integration disregards actual historical fruitfulness of the separationist stance. And interestingly, critics of evolutionist ecology, for instance, Jean Dupré, also exhibits a synthesis bias, from my point of view, because he's criticizing evolutionist psychologists for ignoring culture. But they criticize people like Kroger for ignoring nature, and he's criticizing them for ignoring culture, and I think, come on, each one has the right to ignore the other side. So I'm arguing for a division of labor. And in applied to the case, the nature-culture divide. Just a historical side note, famous case of a synthesis bias, Oppenheim and Putnam and the unity of science as a working hypothesis, since it is, I quote, as has often been remarked, fruitful, the unity of science as a working hypothesis, fruitful in the sense of stimulating many different kinds of scientific research. By way of contrast, belief in the irreducibility of various phenomena has yet to yield a single accepted scientific theory. But let's have a look at history. I want to convince you that already in 1958 this was wrong. But before that, kind of abstract upshot, what is at issue? It should be given. Post-Kuhnian philosophy of science, epistemic values are important. Barker et al. Used for their argument from integration, fruitfulness as a guiding, heuristic fruitfulness as a guiding value, and they connect integration. They have it on the list too, and the synthesis bias is to the connection between the two. I'm not saying that integration is not of value, I'm just saying the connection is Now before I go to the third part, Mozart in some more, a general point. Scientific disciplines proliferated tremendously in the last 200 years, a development that is correlated with an amazingly increase in knowledge. Now, this global development is already reason enough to doubt the argument from integration, to have some doubts on it. Disciplinary differentiation and fruitfulness of science seem to be positively correlated, and those people defending us the integration as the value against separation seem to ignore this. Yet Barker and I probably would not disagree with that correlation between disciplinary differentiation on the global scale and global increase of knowledge if challenged. As mentioned above, it is not reduction or unity of science in our traditional sense, because the issue is not the existence of different disciplines with all their kind of outcomes of disciplines. The issue is not the structure of science. The issue is local integration given different disciplinary perspectives and whether that's always the way to go at the individual level of scientific development. In order to argue for local separation or for separation that's kind of is of equal, it's not separation, not just local, but separation is of equal value than integration. As integration, I have to argue on at an exemplary manner and illustrate a case related to the fields and topics Barker and I were talking about too, namely the establishment of the standards of the science model and here especially cultural anthropology. It is a case, well, the case I want to present is, as I said, Alfred Louis Kroeber, who was the defender of the most radical cultural determinist known in the history of cultural anthropology. And I want to use this case for a couple of philosophical points, and the core of it is how the history of the concept of culture shows how the reconstitution of a field-defining phenomenon helps you to make certain causal factors or certain phenomena to be able to regard them as causally, explanatorily irrelevant, not causally, but explanatorily irrelevant. In the picture you see Alfred Kroeber on the left, student of Franz Boas. Kroeber was very engaged in explicitly in disciplinary identity politics and developed, as I said, a radical cultural determinism. On the right you see Ishii, last member of a Californian tribe that Kroeber studied. And look at the dressing for Kroeber. It was evidently very important to show how culture makes us very similar. And Kroeber became famous at the beginning of the 20th century when anthropology emancipated itself from a museum-based profession to an academic discipline, so curricula, PhDs, journals, associations, etc. And Kroeber was actually Boas' first PhD in anthropology in New York and the ninth in the whole West. Anthropologists were not alone at that time in asking for authority and money, jobs, and intellectual power. Psychology, basically, and the expanding genetics at the time were the most prominent competitors for scientific reputation in terms of studying humans. And Kroeber defended the identity and the importance of cultural anthropology by using the biologist's own concept of heredity. He defined culture as heredity of another sort. So it is a case of heredity, analogous to biological heredity, and analogous and opposed to it. And the opposing, this will be something I will show in a minute. Because it's analogous to biological heredity, biological heredity, something he took from Weissman, who claimed that a cell derives from a cell, derives from a cell, derives from a cell, and now we would add DNA derives from DNA, derives from DNA, Kroeber said, and culture derives from culture, and derives from culture. So culture got defined as a hereditary process, which is the and culture is the explanandum, and it's explained by previous culture. That's the kind of cultural determinism, the basic punchline system. And this move helped him to establish the autonomy of cultural anthropology. Look at this figure. It's from Kroeber's famous paper, The Superorganic from 1917. The figure depicts three distinct and autonomously changing evolutionary processes. You have the dotted line, superorganic, culture on the top. Then you have organic evolution, the dashed line here. And then you have this baseline, that's physical persistence. There's no evolution going on, it's just persistence. And cultural evolution takes off, starting from B, the first individual who was able to learn, and C were the Neanderthals. And B certainly was America at the beginning of the 20th century. Now, the evolutionary process is partitioned into three separate, distinct, and autonomous evolutionary processes. Important are now the epistemic consequences of what he established, not with this figure, but with this cultural determinism, this partitioning of evolution. So you partition one phenomenon, being human, and the evolution of being human, into three distinct autonomic processes. You also established a new separate explanandum, culture. So culture is not explaining human behavior anymore, or is involved in explaining evolution. It's the explanandum. And if it explains something, it explains later culture. And that's important for having something, or a specific explanation for the new specialist on stage, the cultural anthropologists with their new PhDs, etc. Nature becomes a disciplinary primitive. You can safely assume it, but it does not make a difference for the historical change in culture that Kroeber was focusing on. So for this kind of phenomenon, nature does not make a difference because it roughly stays the same. It's explanatory irrelevant. And to think so was far from trivial and fruitful at that time in the history of science. And that's what I wanna, where I wanna dive in. To understand what was so important about this idea, which for us now is, yeah, sure, was far from sure at that time, because people at that time were still believing in Lamarckian inheritance. And Lamarckian inheritance tells you that nature and culture always run in parallel. Because you start with nature, it is expressed in individuals, and then acquired characteristics, the grass, rex, snare, and then this is getting inherited, represented in nature, it is expressed again. So the two lines would have to run in parallel, and there is a causal interaction all the time between them. Now, if that's the case, and then you think, oh, we should explain why there are people like Mozart in among kinds of people, and they do have symphonies, and there are kinds of people like in Samoa that don't have that kind of music. And Herbert Spencer, Lamarckian, even though he's known as social Darwinist, he was a Lamarckian, and defended Lamarckian inheritance as necessary to explain the evolution of musical sense or intelligence in general, said that when we see cultural differences, because of the Lamarckian inheritance, we can infer biological differences from the cultural difference and vice versa, because of the coupling. So if they don't have symphonies in Samoa, they cannot be immortal in Samoa. Now, Weissman said, come on, there can be a Mozart in Samoa once you see that cultural inheritance is an autonomous process in and of itself, because then the two become decoupled. And then you cannot, by observing cultural differences, you cannot infer any biological difference from it anymore. That was the decisive step why, how that kind of evolutionary separation helped to block the scientific racism of that time that rested on a concept of Lamarckian inheritance. So, if one sees that biological inheritance and cultural inheritance are two different systems of inheritance, autonomous, then there's no evidence anymore, because they didn't have access to biological hereditary material. A gene was a theoretical unit here at the time. There's no evidence anymore to not believe in the psychic unity of mankind. So, it follows, the unity of mankind can safely be assumed, and cultural differences can only be explained by the accumulation of cultural differences. Everything picturally, think about the takeoff, that's the important part. Yet it is important to acknowledge that with the decoupling of nature and culture, Kromer did not deny that there still is a shared human nature as well as individual nature. So individual differences between biological difference between individuals. He only denied that individual differences are important. They average out at the culture, that is at the group level, and he stressed that the shared human nature does not make a difference for cultural difference. Nature is therefore a disciplinary primitivum, a phenomenon taken for granted and on top of which our culture happens. Now, if we zoom out a little bit and have a big picture view on the history of the concept of culture and nature in relation to each other from the 19th century to now, we have the following dialectic. It was Spencer. For him, nature and culture was all in one. There's nature and culture is one, generating one indivisible evolutionary process. For Kroeber, nature was almost fixed. It doesn't change much. Culture is on top, and there's no interaction between the two. The one nature is causing that we are able to learn, but it doesn't explain cultural difference, it doesn't explain what the and cultural relativity. Now, co-evolutionary picture today, Chablonka and Lamb are famous, but there are many more, but one quote should be enough here. Nature and culture are separate systems of inheritance, but they're interacting on the evolutionary level. So they're not coupled. but they're separate, they have autonomy, but they can interact. There's two autonomous that they can interact, not twins, one body. Now, epistemically, the following four steps are also important. It's a different way of looking at the history. For Edward Byrne Tyler, the granddaddy of cultural anthropology, mid-19th century, Lamarckian through and through, and everybody was Lamarckian in the mid-19th century, culture was defined as traits of a group of people. It was an explanandum, and he said, irrespective of how it is caused, I don't care how culture is caused to define it. And then Boers was treating culture when he established that the forms of the, Boers was very, had a background very much against racism and tried to show that the immigration laws in the US are unjustified because culture makes a huge difference to how the people behave, and he had a very physiological approach to measure the size of the forms of the heads and showed that they change depending on the environment you're in. So for him, culture was a factor in the development of individuals. So it was part of the explanant. It was not an explanandum. Kroger's main explanandum for the anthropologist was the individual behavior. It was individualist in that sense. Kroger then said, I'm a holist. Individuals are unimportant, averages are. What we have to focus on is a system of inheritance. This is the explanation cultural anthropology should focus on. And now again, coevolutionary theory would treat culture as a factor in evolution. Again, rather than as a, it's assuming that it's a separate explanation, but it's then using it for another phenomenon, namely coevolution between culture and nature. Now, was that fruitful, that separation stance of singling out culture as an autonomous phenomenon where you can ignore nature the way Kroger did? I would say yes, in three ways, at least in three ways. It helped block one detrimental argumentation pattern of early 20th century scientific racism. Now, certainly, even though people still defend and certainly defended scientific racism on all kinds of grounds, I regard Kroger's claim of the autonomy of cultural inheritance and therefore of culture as a historically important insight that helped to block one argumentation pattern for scientific racism. And in the context of the Boer school, that was very successful in blocking that road. You couldn't use Lamarckian inheritance in the sense we were able to use it before. Second point, Kroger's separationist stance was fruitful because it helped to stabilize a young and at that time still very fragile but productive subdiscipline, namely cultural anthropology. So I imagine we have, as Kali mentioned, the kind of like associations, networks we form, they did the same and they struggled hard. So there was the National Science Foundation, and they looked for a representative of anthropology, cultural anthropology. And they have chosen a geneticist. Even though there were cultural anthropologists trained with PhDs and professorships, and they have chosen a geneticist. I mean, you can imagine that one is pissed off by something like that. But we want to be represented as cultural anthropologists. We have something to say that's distinct from what geneticists. And that was a context where they really had to fight hard to establish it. It was not, I mean, history could have been different. They might have lost the fight. And then we would not have that discipline, which is, I would say, still a very productive sub-discipline of anthropology. Third part, it was a historical precondition for contemporary co-evolutionary theories, productive interfield approaches to specific problems regarding how culture and nature act and interact at the evolutionary level. They can't go into the details of coevolutionary theories, but things they do, for instance, is analyzing how exactly was it possible that lactose tolerance was evolving over time. So people sometimes think that food intolerance is a disease, because you can't have latte macchiato as a grown-up. No, that's the natural condition. Those who cannot digest it, that's the history. Those who can digest milk as grown-ups are the diseased ones. But it's quite adaptive, so it's quite good in spread. And they can show that it evolved only because culture was following certain settings, that it was likely that it can evolve historically, evolution. But just as a side, you have to take that now, that they are productive, you have to be with that. Okay, summary of the case. Just, you know, 10 minutes? So my claim is Kroeber defended the place, or what I showed is, tried to show, Kroeber defended the place of culture and anthropology against racist hereditarianism and the new aspiring genetics. He crossed the field of anthropology towards biology and used Weismann's theory of heredity in order to establish clear boundaries between the two disciplines. So he walked over to biology, took some conceptual bits, used it here and built some wars between. This includes the aim to establish for him and his fellow cultural anthropologists the right to ignore human nature, for a while at least, and to focus on culture. And the for a while is important, and here you get a quote from Kroeber. He was himself very methodologically and epistemically minded, and wrote from 1952, but there's a similar position in 1915. I read. It is plain that the most valid and fruitful synthesis, other things being equal, must be the one which is based on the most acute preceding analysis. Such analysis is going to be more effective if directed at one, at an isolated set of factors, than at several interactive ones. Premature and short-circuiting synthesizing is thus avoided by discrimination between the aspects or levels become associated in phenomena, and by unraveling all of this knowledge with which actuality presents us, the facts of one level at a time, and seeing how far they can be traced as such, before retying them into a web of large understanding with the other strands. The level which I have personally chosen or become addicted to is the cultural one. Back to my general argument, one, the argument from fruitful separation. There are then cases, it's an existence claim, where it is more useful in the service of scientific progress to, for a while at least, batten down the hatches of one scientific horizon. Over the long run, it takes two to tango. That's why it's only for a while, but more on that in a minute. In principle, separation as a heuristic strategy can be as fruitful as integration. Whether it is fruitful depends on the context. Today, Kroeber's cultural determinism would not work. Today, you should not ignore the information. So it's always depending on the context whether separation or integration is useful. And the bad side of it is you might not be able to say in the context whether it is useful. Separating oneself in the sense of assuming disciplinary primitives, not in willfully accepting known inconsistencies, but in not checking for consistency, can have fruitful potential. Just an analogy, the separation stance can be as creative as geographic demarcation and evolution. So we learned from Darwin that geographic isolation is very productive in creating the tree of life and the disciplinary the differentiation between biological species, and I claim the same holds for science. The evidence are uses from the history of nature culture. It follows that there's also can establish a specific argument. Since the nature culture divide can be an epistemically fruitful conceptual division of labor, it's useful to demarcate phenomena in that way. The nature culture reward is epistemically defendable, defended. It takes to tengu as a regulative idea. It takes two to tango. It's a slogan I take from Sherrod Hart in 1978. In the long run, it needs separation and integration to have an oscillatory progress. And Kroger's quote kind of illustrated that already. Given that, integration and separation as research strategies have, in principle, equal value because each can be fruitful. But they seem not in the philosophic literature on integration. For instance, Philip Kitcher still wants to have unification, let's say integration in our case now, as the ultimate regulative ideal. Even though he acknowledges that sometimes it's better not to follow the regulative ideal, it's a regulative ideal, and he says the ideal is, I quote, good where we can get it, but not to be imposed willy-nilly. Or De Courier, in a paper on separation integration in cell biology, says, quote, it is a matter of judgment when to take the norm, the regulative ideal of seeking for unity, integration, seriously, but this is no way undercuts the legitimacy of unification as a generally applicable higher level norm. Now, the idea as higher level norm, however, holds only conditionally. I quote again, highlights from me, when work in different disciplines bears on a given problem, their practices, terminologies, and standards for evaluation of experimental evidence must be brought into accord with respect to the matter at hand for it to count as satisfactorily so. What? Problems are not simply given. They are reconstituted, as in Kroger's case, so that there is a functioning division of labor between them. So certainly you can integrate if you don't want to divide the problems, but you can also divide the problem, and it's a matter of choice what you opt for in such a situation. All I'm aiming at with this thing now is there is, you can't put integration at a higher level. Okay, for the consequence and the tree of science, and then I'm done. Whether integration or separation happens is contingent. I said it already, that we have a cultural anthropology that produces useful scientific knowledge is not a necessary result of necessary differentiation of disciplines and certain joints, predetermined joints of intellectual speciation. No, that's not the case. It's historical contingent whether and where exactly disciplines differentiate. At least I don't know of an argument showing something to the contrary. And the same holds for integration. Second point. There's no correlation between the synthesis bias of valuing integration higher than separation and political goals. It has been stressed that the rarity for unity of science in the Vienna Circle had also political motivation against the nationalism and racism of Europe of that time. And the kind of epistemic solution was unity. And Kroger had the exact same political enemy and the exact opposite epistemic strategy and was successful. So even though there's a relation between political goals and unity or integration, synthesis as an ideal in science, the relation is not a clear, strict correlation. It's a complex relation between the two things. And there's only local integration possible if separation and integration form the cooperation in tangu. It takes the chi to tangu, and tangu means to have scientific progress, then the different perspectives stay separate, but there is integration at a local level at certain points in the history, and you get a beautiful tree of knowledge with separation and integration in all kinds of places. This is a figure from Alfred Kroger, 1948. He used it for culture. What I wanted to present is that science has the structure of that kind of knowledge, not as hierarchical as a tree, but with separation and integration in tangu. Thank you for your attention.